Welcome, welcome to the Road to Recovery, the Road to Freedom with Mark. This is my half-hourly slot every Friday where I talk to you a little bit about mental illness, about depression and bipolar disorder and OCD, attention deficit disorder. There's all kinds of illnesses that people might suffer, and you know, sometimes you don't have just one of them, you might have a string of them, which unfortunately I do. But it's all about managing things, learning to manage things, and looking for the signs. When you start becoming absent-minded, forgetful, and angering very quickly, becoming very frustrated, repetitive thoughts, especially repetitive negative thoughts, those are some of the subtle signs that you learn about yourself. And managing mental illness can just be all about holding on sometimes, because you go through these waves, these highs and lows, often with depression, especially with things like bipolar. You go soaring up, and the high highs are wonderful, but then you come crashing down, and those low lows are, yeah, life-threatening in some cases, very difficult to handle. And one of the things that I do is I have this little box of tricks, these positive thoughts of great achievements in my life, great days. I have a list of them in my head. I mean, it doesn't hurt to write them down either, you know, about some of the things, and even write down a story of a great day that you had, not for anyone else, just for yourself. Write it down, and as you write it down, all these thoughts will come back to you about that great day that you had, and that can just lift you up and give you a good feeling. Once you've done it, it's up to you, but personally, I screw them up and throw them in the rubbish bin, and then I do it again on another day when I need it. And it's a good little technique just to remind yourself that not every day is down. So when you are feeling down, just remember it's not forever. It's not always. And, you know, it's like the loss of a loved one. It's always so devastating when it happens. You think you're never going to be well again and you're going to be broken forever. And maybe in some ways you are, but that pain does desist in time. It does relinquish its grip on you. And bit by bit, you can get better, a step at a time. And that's what it's all about, is just one foot in front of the other. You know, don't expect to make great leaps forward. Just try a little bit at a time. I mean, that's how you eat the elephant. A bite at a time, my friend. Well, I've got an interesting song for you today. Hang on, I'll grab it. Here it is. Now, this is a well-covered old tune, but I tell you what, this is the most stonking version I've ever heard. Many Rivers to Cross, and it is by UB40, believe it or not. It's amazing that they did that track. Every now and then I find a band will do something that absolutely astounds me, and I think, no way, truly, is that them? And this is one of them. You will love it today. But first we're going to get on with the story. A place that is near and dear to my heart. The greatest time that I ever had in my entire life. And boy, I have had some high highs, and I've been to some most amazing places in my life. And you know, I lived in London. That was a treat. I loved London long before I ever saw her. And you know, Istanbul, that's Cape Town, all these incredible things. But the best time I had in my life was when I lived in Africa. I didn't have to work. I spent all my time getting drunk and driving around through game parks and stuff. And you know, I watched the wildebeest migration up in the Tanzania on TV the other day, and it's no different in southern Africa. And it's just absolutely incredible. The sense of freedom, the number of animals that you see, these huge wild animals in Africa. I mean, New Zealand is rete petite in comparison. You know, we have some nice little birds and stuff, but we don't have elephants and lions and stuff. And when I saw that, actually in the wild, no cage, no bars, you know, no subjugated animals. These things were truly wild and free, and it was an experience that still blows me away today, more than 30 years later. Speaking of 30 years, I just want to say one more thing before I go. Richard Hadley, well done, sir. An amazing achievement pretty much 30 years ago, that 374 wickets. I will never forget watching the man. To my mind, the greatest cricketer that ever played the game. I mean, if you're a bowler, you're there doing the damage, and he could break the back of an entire team. You know, such was the man's ability. There has never been one before. There has never been one since like him. Sir Richard Hadley, you, sir, are an amazing man, and they should put a statue up in the middle of Christchurch to celebrate you. One of the best athletes that ever lived. One other thing, T.G. McCarthy Trust, thank you very much for sponsoring our show. Really appreciate it. Nice to have you on board. Thanks very much. Right, I've wasted an entire 6 minutes, so we're going to have to crack on with this one. This is one of my favourites, Travels in South Africa. Here we go. I lived in South Africa for the reign of the last two white presidents, Pik Botha and F.W. de Klerk. In 2.5 years, I travelled down the garden route of the East Coast, back up through the middle to Johannesburg and Pretoria. What struck me in the first few days in Johannesburg was the armed soldiers standing on every corner of every governmental building. I felt great unease at the sight of machine guns in the hands of young men. Racial segregation was still apparent everywhere, from the all-black labouring gangs on building sites to all-white industries like the legal system. There was a sense of nervousness and civil unrest, with the neighbouring Soweto slums splitting at the seams. There were constant reports of killings at rallies and funerals for political radicals. Nelson Mandela was still on Robben Island at the time I arrived, but it was obvious he would soon be released. That would be the catalyst for true democracy and the end of the current apartheid regime. It was obvious the country itself was not ready for all the changes that were about to happen. The five major home states of the black people had no infrastructure, lacking simple things like power and water to homes. They were little more than unsightly slums that were in stark contrast to the rest of the country. All of the country outside these home states had an air of normality, and the main cities of each state seemed quite successful despite world trade sanctions. Every city had its own version of segregation, with the Afrikaners living in affluent suburbs in Johannesburg with huge fences around their perimeters. Every fence was solid and topped with broken bottles and razor wire, giving them a typical fortress effect. The other white tribe were the English speakers, who spoke English as a first language and held English passports. They lived in suburbs with lower fences but bars on every door and window. The two white tribes were segregated in subtle ways in Johannesburg, but the black people were forced to live in neighbouring Soweto, which at the time numbered some 5 million souls living in poverty. The populations of the white people in each city had a noticeably nicer neighbourhood and had better schooling for their kids. That led to better job opportunities for jobs and industries run by their own people. The system was self-supporting, as South Africa is still rich in diamonds and gold. Fortunes extracted from the earth, however, did not translate to an even spread of wealth. At the other end of the scale, there were 33 black tribes in South Africa, some of which had no real representation in government and suffered terribly as a result. The people of Indian descent were caught in the middle and referred to as coloured. They had some political representation in places like Durban in the Natal province. About a quarter of Durban was made up of Indians, and it surprised me to see such large numbers of Indians. In nearby Ladysmith, their famous son, Mahatma Gandhi, worked as a lawyer before becoming famous for his peace protesting and political career. Despite some influence, they lived as second-class citizens and tended to live mainly along the east coast. In Durban, there are some 11 kilometres of beautiful coastline, with wonderful beaches all the way round. In the middle, on the wealthiest section of the strip, were two beautiful skyscrapers, the Maharani and the Ilangini. One had a glass lift up the outside of the building to a nightclub at the top. Despite its political isolation, places like Durban, with its massive port, managed to thrive. Apartheid had a weaker hold on the population of Durban as opposed to Pretoria and Johannesburg. It seemed to lessen as we headed south and away from the spiritual and political homeland of the Afrikaners. So it seemed to hold true as we pulled into Cape Town with its incredible Table Mountain and Lion Rock. Cape Town itself seemed far more at ease with itself, with far less obvious segregation. We booked ourselves an apartment in the Green Lane area of the Cape and returned to take the gondola ride up Table Mountain, which is a flat plateau. The view from the top was simply breathtaking as the mountain offered a 180-degree panoramic view. It felt like God's window on the world from up there and reminded me of the Drakensberg Ranges with its spectacular views over the city below. No matter which direction you look at in this beautiful city, Table Mountain dominates with its awe-inspiring presence. Cape Town had some decent nightlife as well. We found a place called the Pig and Whistle, which was a great place for a feed, then drink and dance to a local rock band. We had a great time there, drinking and dancing on the tables, as was the custom there. There was a noticeable lessening of segregation here too, with all races allowed on the same buses and some of the same beaches. Even so, there was talk of the local Cape Malay people suffering poverty and squatter camps springing up on the outskirts. In all our travels around Southern Africa, Cape Town was probably the most relaxed and free from the political plague that apartheid had become. Its great beauty is icing on the cake, and it is a place that stays long in the memory, as it must rate as one of the most beautiful cities in the world. Altogether too soon, we headed up country from Cape Town to Stellenbosch, through the Little and Great Karoo to Kimberley. The famous diamond mining town featured a 1 kilometre hole in the ground, and the area still produces diamonds to this day. The area also features some particularly fine vineyards, and we were treated to some wonderful wine. Even so, there was a marked difference in the political situation as we drove up north. By the time we reached the Orange Free State, we were back to the old South Africa we had witnessed in Pretoria and Johannesburg. It was strange to witness different versions of apartheid in the one place. All of the country was in a state of permanent change, like it or not. The last two successive white governments realised they were little more than night watchmen, waiting for the new South Africa to be born. They mainly concerned themselves with trying to keep law and order and stop the country from spiralling into war, as so many of its neighbours had done. All right, take a little bit of a break. Yeah, we'll take a little bit of a break. And I'll play you that song I was talking about. I think you're going to like this one. Let's see what you think. Sorry, got to go forward. Oh, we want number 20, don't we? That's the one. Here we go.
Oh,
Welcome back to The Road to Recovery, The Road to Freedom with Mark. I hope you enjoyed that. Something very unusual, wasn't it? If you can get past all the popping and blinging and weird 80s sounds, yeah, amazing lyrics. Love it, song. Right, we've got to crack on. Let's go. Travels in South Africa. You'll like this bit. One of the more interesting little adventures happened in Durban when we went to the Curry Cup rugby finals. Standing out as Kiwis meant we met plenty of people interested in our journey and our impressions of the country. They were wonderful hosts, and one guy, Dave, offered to introduce us to a rugby-mad friend, RP Kitching, who lived with his family under a local stadium. He took us from Kings Park to Parks Rugby Club to meet Arpy, who immediately asked the four of us to stay with him and meet some of his friends. Arpy, who was Afrikaans, and his wife, an English speaker, were wonderful hosts and lived in an amazing flat built under the stadium Arpy looked after. We stayed for a few days before Arpy took us out to the countryside to Potenzing to meet some friends who grew oranges for a living. We didn't know what to expect and were amazed to see orchards as far as the eye could see in a valley serviced by a large dam they had built for themselves. We were taken to the homestead of Zol Ferreira, a descendant of Portuguese and Afrikaans, who had carved out an oasis for themselves in very harsh land. As well as oranges, Zol had an ostrich farm for extra income. Another relative and neighbour kept antelopes for local consumptions in local braai fests or barbecue fests held for all the local folks. The first day and night we stayed there, Zol turned on one of these massive feasts for the four of us. All of the neighbours from miles around came over to meet us, and it turned out most of them were related. They lived in their valley, pretty isolated from the rest of the country, in a small microcosm of South Africa. Whilst there, we met a relative, Espy Ferreira, the richest of the orchardists, who invited us to come over and visit. He owned a massive orchard in the middle of the valley, along with the local packing sheds, a bottle store, and a few other shops in the small village he and his ancestors had built. He also had many black folks working for him, and their families lived on his land in very primitive conditions. The orchardists there could not see why the black workers should live any differently, despite the massive contrast in their lives. Even so, the orchardists were heavily armed in case of civil uprising. They were very isolated in Potenzi, and almost all of them belonged to the Dutch Reformed Church and are staunch believers. We stayed at Zol Ferreira's place, as they had plenty of room with servants to help run the place. It was very strange for me to be waited on by maids, but they seemed very happy with their situation. There was also plenty of land and hills to explore, and on our third night there, we headed up the back of the property to catch some live game. The idea was to spotlight the antelope using utes, then to herd them up and jump off the back of the utes and rugby tackle them and tie them up. It was a dangerous exercise jumping off the back of utes at some speed, so was left for the black folks to do. I joined up with them in the back of the ute, and soon we were jumping out to tackle a poor panicking antelope. A few guys got quite badly banged up, and we managed to capture three female buck, which were trussed up and transported to a local farm. I was surprised that everyone took their situation in life without question or complaint, but that was how they had grown up and had never known any different. Even so, it was difficult to talk to the black folks living in Potenzi, as they did not want to offend the white orchardists who employed them. It seemed there was little option for them, and schooling was a luxury not afforded them. I felt sad for them, as I could not see that any form of democracy would change their lot. This was the case in much of South Africa, and no magic wand of political change would would free people from their predestined place in society. The black people living in Potenzin seemed to care little for the changes about to happen, and it was obvious that significant change would happen a generation at a time. It had to start with literacy and political awareness before any significant change could take place. As far as the Auxitists were concerned, they had carved out this piece of paradise with their own hands and could not see any reason for change. They were worried that the future would bring change to their well-ordered society and the country would fall into chaos. They had already watched on as Angola, Mozambique, Northern and Southern Rhodesia had gone through civil war and fallen into rack and ruin. They did not believe that Mandela could bring change without civil uprising, and their fears seemed well-founded. They did not, however, see anything wrong with the existing system as it offered stability and certainty. In the end, however, it was a numbers game, and when everyone in the country was granted a vote, their point of view would be swept aside in a wave of change. Our hosts were really decent people who could not do enough for us, so I felt sorry for them as well as they faced a world of change. The future was uncertain, but everyone hoped it would spell the end of the political sanctions and allow South Africa to rejoin the rest of the free world. I was surprised at the Afrikaans' resilience despite being in the political wilderness. For all of its troubles, it was easily the most sophisticated and robust of the countries we visited in Southern Africa. That resilience gave me hope that they would find a way to cope with the change about to come. After a wonderful and enlightening stay at Potenzin, it was altogether too soon that we had to say goodbye. The valley really was a microcosm of South Africa itself, with an uncertain future, but the potential to grow and flourish with new change. In the many years since I visited South Africa, the ANC's Mandela government came and went. It did not deliver the hope for change, but to me was astonishing for the lack of bloodshed. The Mandela government was able to convey the message of hope, and especially forgiveness. This stopped the country from descending into civil war and allowed a smoother transition from white to majority rule. I was surprised at the lack of civil unrest and hoped this peaceful beginning would lead to a prosperous future. Unfortunately, this was too much to expect, as South Africa was very set in its ways and not all change could happen quickly. Many people hoped for immediate change, whereas real and meaningful change will more likely take generations. I think the Mandela years delivered all it was capable of. I hope the future will bring the freedoms all of South Africa's people yearn for. I believe it is now up to all of the countries who placed embargoes and sanctions to deliver on promises of acceptance and open trade. I expect, however, South Africa will take a long time to recover, and I feel sorry for all those wonderful people I met on my journeys. I look back now on that journey with a melancholy heart, as it is a place where I left a little piece of myself. I will never forget the promise of the burning sunrise and the incredible red sunsets of a place I came to love. I hope for her a better future. The end. There we go. That's us for the week. I just want to say thank you very much for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed it. I love bringing you this show and I look forward to bringing you a whole heap more. T.G. McCarthy Trust, Whammo, thank you very much for coming on board. Anyone else who wants to make a contribution, ring ring. Just give Michael or Veronica a call. We're always happy if you can sponsor shows. It helps the magic happen, you know, and this is a very worthwhile exercise. Thanks to Wairarapa TV, Arrow Radio. Check us out on computer, on radio, on TV. Give it a go. It's it's a really great thing. Thanks, and we will catch you next week. Bye for now. Thank you.